On this, the inaugural episode of my new television show, we are very pleased to have the always outspoken Oliver Stone as our premier guest. The permanently vibrant Heidi May welcomes Slater Kinney to the Bomb Shelter to kick off an unparalleled season of exclusive musical performances. And I'll finally give Keanu Reeves the credit he so richly deserves. It's going to be a great show and a great season, folks, so stay right here. Gentlemen, I'm back for another season. And what's changed in the world since I've been gone? Absolutely nothing. The war in Iraq is still an ever-worsening disaster. Jobs continue to hemorrhage out of this country. Our borders are, in fact, open doors saying, come on in. And the Bush administration seems hell-bent on bending the rules, treating the Constitution like an abstract tone poem, greasing the corporate rails, and selling America off to the highest bidder in his war on terror. You're in credit debt, and Ken Lay makes bail. And while all hell is breaking loose, the media seems to give almost equal time to Hollywood red carpet walks as they do to the lack of change in Katrina-ravaged parts of the South. But do you know what else hasn't changed? Me. Because I'm still pissed off about it, and I'm not afraid to let you know. So this season will continue to reflect what I believe in and what I find interesting. And you're going to see that in every aspect of this show, featuring the most uncensored conversations in television with the musicians, filmmakers, and artists who have a lot more to talk about than what award show they're going to or who they're currently dating. Because I want to know about their work, how they did it, how it affected them, and how they hope it will affect others. Beyond that, we've decided to open the show up to bands that matter. With the help of my friend and co-combatant Heidi May, we're creating a musical platform for completely uncensored and unrestricted performances by legends and emerging artists to play what they really want to play. And I'll be here on IFC every week to comfort you with my sensitive commentary. So mark your calendars, set your TiVos, and spread the word, because we plan on making some serious noise. Joining me now is filmmaker, historian, and American veteran Oliver Stone, who is kind enough to take a break from production on his upcoming film entitled World Trade Center, a drama centered around the 9/11 attacks. Oliver, thanks for coming on the show.
Henry.
It's good to see you. How's the film coming?
Good. We finished shooting in New York and Los Angeles, and then we are editing, hopefully for release in August or September or October, one of those three.
It's often difficult getting financing for films. Was this particularly difficult because of the subject matter?
I think it was an issue, definitely, but it was decided and resolved quickly. It wasn't dragged out. I mean, it was something that I came to the script late. It had been written earlier by and developed by Michael Schanberg and Stacey Scher with Deborah Hill. And I came to it and I read it, and it was one of the few pieces that I ever read that was, I could see the movie. It felt like it was working and close to working. And I think the time had changed since 2001, so there was a bit of a change in the wind.
With films like JFK, Nixon, and World Trade Center, you're depicting reality and history, but you're also making drama. And so what's the line that you tread, keeping the facts and everything intact and yet making it dramatic and viewable?
The thing with World Trade Center is we have the living participants in the drama.
Right.
So they're all, they've been most helpful, the McLaughlins and the Jimenos. And we've had them on the set, and the actors have consulted them. You're almost enacting immediate history, in a sense.
Right. Well, then let's talk about JFK and Nixon, where you're going from decades ago, and there's lots of versions of the truth.
It's called historical drama. It existed since Shakespeare, and it actually existed since the ancient Greeks. Nobody knows what happened between Mr. and Mrs. Nixon behind closed doors, or who really killed Kennedy. We don't know, except the persons who were involved.
Right.
So we are all speculating. And I am playing it as a dramatist. I'm saying, what's the best story that we can make that is true to the spirit of these facts? You know, as movies, you have to put together 500 facts. You got to whittle them down to maybe 3 or 5 or 6. That's the way movies are. They're simplistic,
right?
Relatively simplistic. But you make those 6 fucking things accurate as you can to what you believe.
Do you see any parallels from the Nixon administration and the Bush administration in that bending the rules or just walking right by them, a sneakiness?
I wish we'd made Nixon now. Nixon would be a hit today. I think it would be a success because it really would frighten people to see that Bush has gone so far beyond Nixon. What Bush has pulled off is remarkably spectacular. I mean, he's broken all these treaties, which Nixon couldn't have done. He's started a war. He added to the budget in a way that nobody at that time, in my memory, would ever even get close to. Senate, the Congress in those days, it meant something. It was not a husk. It's sort of as if in my lifetime, I've seen the Roman Republic become an empire. The love of the chief executive, the love of ego, the absorption in one. And it comes from our culture. It's like we loved the winner. Who won the Super Bowl? Nobody remembers number 2. There's no respect for the concept of number 3, 4, 5. The people who work at something, you know, the love of work, the respect for craftsmanship. That's sort of part of inherent in that culture. So when you get into this number 1, he's the president. Oh man, that's the only thing that matters. He can do whatever he wants. He can make the laws. He can eavesdrop what he wants. He can declare war forever on everybody and get away with it. And nobody can question it because we're all intimidated, so to speak, by this president.
At least the media seems to be. Where the media...
Well, they frighten people. They scare us off if you criticize. Well, you, they expect it, but for me, that's different. If we're Hollywood wackos and all that stuff, left wing, which is an easy and facile dismissal and denial of somebody's, I'm still a citizen, I've served my country as a veteran, I've had many jobs before the film business. You know, I know something of life having lived to this age, I have something. I'm not saying, and we have a right to speak. And every time we speak, they say, oh, you're an actor, I'm a show business director, you know, we're making it up. We invent fiction. This is not a way of dealing with people. This is slander.
Yeah, I think that as Americans, we need to be pillars ourselves.
Yes.
Because the onus of freedom, we should feel the pressure of it every day. I mean, we should feel responsible for it, in fear of it, and wanting to serve it and protect it.
I agree.
For a guy who's always wearing his American flag button, and a guy who would probably tell me to get out of his country, I think these people should get out of mine.
Bush, he has so much media power. I mean, it's... even in opposition, he can be a dictator. Basically, he's a dictator.
Yeah.
I don't think that George Bush has any sense of shame. He's very good at this. He's very strong in the way, and I would never underestimate his inner strength that way, his conviction.
You're a Viet vet. You've addressed it in your movies. Do you see any parallels? Do you see that we didn't learn the lessons or ignored the lessons of Vietnam?
We did ignore. I mean, it's a continual it's mankind's failing too, not to remember history. We do the same things, the same exact things in a different way. Escalation towards war, media buildup, pounding drums, not thinking, not arguing, getting the whole Senate to vote one way, practically. It was the same thing then. The Senate voted, as you know, the Tonkin Resolution, which was again a hysterical document that was cooked up the same way the Patriot Act was cooked up.
Yeah, and kind of a ruination of the greatest mechanism I've ever witnessed in my entire life, which is, for me, democracy. Because I downloaded the Patriot Act and tried to read it. You know, like, I'm some you know, rube. I just like, okay, you can't read it. It's this Kafkaesque, oblique legalese. I don't think it's meant to be read or understood. I know the president hasn't read it. It's massive. It's like 65,000 words. I don't think it's made to be read by mere mortals. I don't know who's read it.
It's bullshit. It really is bullshit, this Patriot Act. I don't want to get into that because it gets me angry, but this is like the nightmare from which we have to awake, and I hope to God we will in our lifetime because this could be a long nightmare.
Yeah.
This thing, it's like the Gang of Four in China, and they have really changed this country enormously. The decision-making has been enormously bold. Because they are ideologues and they're very dangerous. I mean, the Gang of Four would be what? Bush, Cheney, Rumsfeld, and Rice, those four. Powell was the great failure of liberalism to me because he was a conservative to begin with, Colin Powell. He was in Vietnam. He was a conservative, liberal black man. He was going to be the force of gravitas and experienced authority in this new administration, if you remember. And he wasn't. He did nothing. In the end, he would have to live with himself. And as much as I admire him in so many ways, I think that that's the worst type of man in history. In a way, he's doomed because he didn't use his strength when he had that shot. Mm. He should have fucking resigned in the middle of it if he was against the war. Or when he found out that the UN, he duped the people at the UN speech. I mean, these are...
But holding up the vial?
Whatever.
Yeah.
He should have resigned. And he didn't. And to this day, I think that he's damned. He's damned himself. But those people are ideologues. They get very dangerous. And when sanity returns, which hasn't, because when sanity returns to this country, we'll know it. We'll feel it.
Yeah.
I mean, a madness sets in. And logic, open debate, humanity gets... That's what war is. War is not a state of war. It's a diminutization of humanity. And that's what's going on. It's an impoverishment of the culture, too.
So, is there a way out?
We have to kind of break it down a bit, deconstruct, get less angry, more loving, more personal responsibility. I hate to see this country change so much. It's people like me should speak up. We are the age. It's too late otherwise.
I agree. I like all those things you said. I appreciate you coming down to say
it. No, appreciate it.
Really?
Thank you.
All right. Still to come on the show, Heidi May brings us an exclusive performance by Slater Kinney. But first, a letter to Laura Bush.
Dear Miss Bush, I'm writing you today out of a genuine concern for you and your wonderful daughters. First of all, please allow me to compliment you on standing by your man, our president. I know how unbelievably trying, embarrassing, and infuriating it must be for you at times. I know you're college educated, literate, a librarian no less, and that conversations with George W. Bush may be reminiscent of the time you waved and said hello to the gorillas at the San Diego Zoo a few years ago, or trying to establish a meaningful dialogue with a bowl of wax fruit. Your patience is only matched by their perpetual frozen expression of fear, heartbreak, and startled surprise that cries out, "I self-medicate. I'm on half a bottle of Stoli and a fistful of Zoloft before noon." I see you at his side as he visits Louisiana and dodges questions about FEMA and the lack of aid going to people in that region. You are with him every step of the way as his approval ratings continually sink. Your wonderful monologue at the correspondence dinner months ago had me in stitches. They should rename you the First Lady of Comedy. You know, you and I have a lot in common. Neither of us feel any safer since the invasion of Iraq, and both of us read. We both have an attention span that lasts longer than half an hour, and we both have a sense of humor. That being said, I'm going to go out on a limb here and offer my friendship to you. I have to think we could have a better time than what you're used to. I mean, come on, how many hours of a drunken Lynn Cheney reading aloud from Mein Kampf can anyone stand? If you do want to hang out, think of all the fun we could have. We could go to one of the many American seaports and watch weapons of mass destruction get waved in by Dubai nationals. We could light bags of dog dew on fire at Hillary Clinton's doorstep, ring the buzzer, and run like hell. All I'm saying, Ms. Bush, is I know you're suffering your husband as much as I am, and we might as well get our kicks before the whole shithouse goes up in flames. What do you say? Henry.
I've been accused of being old-fashioned on occasion, resistant to many of the wonderful advances in technology that are supposed to make our lives easier and more fulfilling. But that all changed recently when somebody gave me a BlackBerry. Just the sound of it provides me with a sense of comfort. It's so slick. BlackBerry. I love email. It's another way to communicate with somebody without having to see or hear them. It's perfect. The problem was, when my wit was on fire and I absolutely had to send 50 emails in a row, I was trapped and completely immobile and I'd go days without leaving my desk. This addiction tragically ended after a 2-week sit-down email bender that resulted in a blackout. A laptop helped for a while, and I loved the mobility of it, but I got sick of having to creep around my neighbor's yard to steal their Wi-Fi connection. So when I got the BlackBerry, I knew my life would change. With this little guy, I'm emailing everything that's happening to me all the time, all the time. Movies used to be such a one-dimensional experience for me. Even the best that cinema had to offer was just on one faraway screen. It's so 20th century. But now, how much better is a movie if I'm watching it while emailing my friend about the couple totally making out in the front row? And I have to admit, even sex was getting a little redundant, but with my BlackBerry, it's like a newfangled menage a trois. Virtually everything is better with a BlackBerry in hand. And I don't know why I was so hesitant to accept such an obvious necessity. Life is just so darn short, and if you love life as much as I do, you barely sleep. But perhaps you too should consider the BlackBerry movement. Think about it the next time you're on the way to lethal injection with nothing to read. And now, here's Heidi May with this week's musical performance from Slater Kinney.
Thanks, Henry. Hailing from the Pacific Northwest, this trio was founded on the independent attitude of punk rock. Their explosive guitars and intricate vocal harmonies created a punk pop powerhouse that cannot be confined to the term girl band. Performing the song Entertain off their hugely successful album, The Woods, here's Slater Kinney, Uncut.
Entertained, please.
This week's end credits go to Rainer Fassbinder and, believe it or not, Keanu Reeves. Rainer Fassbinder is perhaps one of the most important directors of our time. As a German filmmaker, he assembled a career's worth of films rooted in counterculture themes which prominently featured homosexuality. Resigned to the fact that he could never achieve mainstream success with his movies, he stayed true to his art, never compromising his portrayal of societal elements that no one else had the guts to address. Now, good old Keanu deserves his own acknowledgement for putting his career on the line and in the hands of Gus Van Sant for 1992's My Own Private Idaho. It was a provocative film with homosexual themes, and I would imagine the role was not cool with management, if you know what I mean. But Keanu jumped in regardless and delivered a noteworthy performance opposite the late River Phoenix. So, while Heath Ledger and Jake Gyllenhaal continue to bask in their awards glory, please know when you pick up Brokeback Mountain on DVD that it's not the only gay film that was ever made. It just may be the first gay Western. Thank you again to my guests, Oliver Stone and Slater Kinney. Join us next week when our special guest will be Chuck D of Public Enemy and our musical guest, Jurassic 5. See you then.